the audience. Now, we have a wonderful panel of educators to inform us tonight. With us is Jackie Charles. Hi, Jackie. Jackie is the Northern District Education Centre Churchill Fellow for 2019, and her presentation tonight explores her research into providing court education to school students. So welcome, Jackie. Joining Jackie is Robert Lawson. Robert was awarded his fellowship in 2017 to investigate transition programs from school to work for students with disabilities. So welcome, Robert. Completing our panel is Kathy Little. Hi, Kathy. Kathy is the Nancy Fairfax Churchill Fellow for 2018. Her fellowship was to investigate best practices of an inclusive education model for students with autism. So welcome, Kathy. I think you'll all agree that the panel's research and interests cover a wide range of educational issues. So we are in for a very informative night. Kathy, you're the first cab off the rank tonight, but before I hand over to you, I just want to tell everybody a little about yourself. Kathy is a senior lecturer at the University of Sydney, lecturing in the field of special education in the School of Education and Social Work. Her particular interest and research lies in the areas of autism spectrum disorder, ASD, positive behaviour support, and student mental health. Kathy currently lectures at both undergraduate and postgraduate levels, as well as supervising a number of research students. She was recently appointed as a visiting professor at Yogyakarta National University in Indonesia, and I hope I got that pronunciation. Kathy acts as a consultant to schools for the support of students who have ADSD and challenging behaviours, and sits on the board of directors of Joseph Varga School, a school for students with ASD. So over to you, Kathy.
Thank you very much, Peter, and welcome everybody. So I'm just going to share my screen with you. Okay, can you see that? I'm hoping you can. And let's just minimize that. All right, so I'm aware of the time, so I'll get started. So as Peter mentioned, my fellowship, I was very fortunate to travel overseas to investigate a best practice inclusive education model for school students on the autism spectrum. And I'm greatly indebted to the Fairfax Foundation and for their scholarship, as I was awarded the Nancy Fairfax Churchill Fellowship in 2018. Before I begin, I'd just like to echo Ian's sentiments by paying my respects to the peoples of the Gadigal Nation on which whose land I live and I work when I'm working at home, and pay my respects to elders past, present and emerging, and any Aboriginal colleagues who may find themselves present tonight or watching this video. So before I start, I just want to very briefly touch on what autism is. Most people know of autism, but a lot of people have a bit of a misconception about what autism actually is and how it presents, and oftentimes we refer to very stereotypical representations of autism. So not everyone who sits on the autism spectrum is Rain Man, and not everyone who sits on the autism spectrum, you know, has savant or splinter skills. It is a spectrum disorder. It's a very complex developmental disability that affects parts of the brain and central nervous system. And because of that impact on the brain, it affects how a person interacts with people, how they interact with their environment, and that comes through in some very, sometimes very different and unique behaviours. And it also impacts upon their abilities to use language and communication in a more traditional way. It's important to understand that no two people experience autism in the same way. The areas of the brain that are affected are different in every single person who receives a diagnosis of autism. So if you know one person with autism, you know one person with autism. We can't make the mistake of thinking that it's similar in everyone. It doesn't. It represents and presents very differently in all persons on the spectrum. But what I find is that we tend to look at a very deficit approach towards autism when we need to be thinking about the fact that people with autism present with many, many strengths. So my background as a teacher and as an academic was working in the area of autism spectrum disorder. I was a teacher for a number of years on autism, well, as an executive level teacher, supporting students on the autism spectrum. And a lot of my students were in mainstream classes, and I was constantly working with their teachers to respond to, oh, this student's academically able, you know, they don't have any particular need. And if you know anything about autism at all, autism can present as a very socially driven disorder. And although students might be academically able, a lot of our students in regular settings are not receiving the social supports that they need to be successful and to create friendships, to maintain those sorts of friendships. And education itself is a really social endeavour, and we have a responsibility as teachers to make sure our students are socially prepared and socially adept to survive school, but then also to survive life. So I was really driven by this notion to find a way of embedding a best practice inclusive education model for children and young people with autism that had a really strong social focus. And I used my fellowship to do just that. So what I found was a program called the ASD NEST program. And it's a K-12 inclusive school education program that serves children and students with autism in regular mainstream settings and communities. So they're in classes alongside their peers with a decreasing reliance on professional supports, which means that our students who are in mainstream classes, a lot of our response, our traditional responses are to provide them with an SLSO or a teacher aide or paraprofessional, when in effect all the research says that to just simply do that decreases the social engagement and involvement of students with disabilities. So I was really keen to look at a project or an intervention that had such a strong social focus, but that was actually being successfully implemented in regular classes, and I came upon the NEST program. The principles of a NEST class are as follows here. It's a smaller class size in terms of student numbers. It looks at having 16 to 20 students, including 4 students with a diagnosed autism spectrum disorder. A NEST class runs on a co-teaching model, which means that it has two trained teachers, not one teacher and a paraprofessional, but two trained teachers, one generalist teacher and one teacher that has targeted special ed qualifications. But both of those teachers are trained in the NEST model, in the NEST program. The NEST class also has access to a targeted speech pathologist who provides what are called social development intervention sessions every day. And these sessions are run with the targeted students with autism to focus around social skills and social development. But the social development sessions are also run with the rest of the class to provide that peer support and peer infrastructure for the specific social skills that the students are learning, students with autism are learning in their SDI intervention sessions. In a NEST class, the students access the same curriculum. There is no differentiated curriculum for students on the spectrum, but there is provision for a quiet space in the class for students to use to self-regulate, and there is a strong emphasis on the use of visuals, which is an identified evidence-based strategy for students on the autism spectrum. So you can see that in a lot of our classrooms in New South Wales, most of these things are possible and can be happening, but there are probably some few differences that I'll talk a little bit more about. So my fellowship involves spending time in NEST schools in New York, in New York City, and in Aarhus in Denmark. I spent time in schools and with NYU, New York University researchers to gain an understanding of the NEST model and actually how it works in practice. It's very easy to look at an intervention that looks to be successful, but I actually wanted to see what it meant for classroom teachers and for students in schools. I wanted to meet with school administrators. I wanted to meet with teachers, with parents, with students and their families to actually see, does it work? And if it does work, why does it work and how does it work? And how can we actually examine the portability of the model? Is it only going to work in America? Is it only going to work in Denmark? what were the things that perhaps I needed to be cognizant of in terms of moving it to the Australian context. So I started my fellowship going to Aarhus in Denmark, where I went to four NEST schools, three primary schools and one early childhood setting to see the model in action. The staff in Aarhus had been trained by the people in New York where the project emerged and had taken the model back to Aarhus to see what it was like, to see if they could use it. Three of the four NEST sites were using elements of NEST, and there was only one true NEST class. However, as I was leaving Aarhus at the end of 2019, the Danish government had taken on NEST and were looking to implement NEST across the whole country. So I'm working with colleagues at the moment in Denmark to see what that rollout is actually looking at. So it has received quite significant support from the government. I was interested in one of the schools in Sonderbankskolen. It was a secondary school that I visited where they set up different learning centres in the school, and I thought this was particularly apt. Their Senate section, where the students had their school Senate meetings, had a quote there by Winston Churchill, which I thought was quite apt considering I was there on my fellowship. I then spent, after a week in Denmark, went to New York, where I had 5 weeks looking at 6 different schools, 2 elementary, 2 middle and 2 high schools, and I saw the NEST programs in each of these schools. NEST was started in New York City in 2003, and it now serves 1,500 students across 54 schools across all of the 5 boroughs of New York City. I did speak with school staff, leaders and students, both students with and without autism, about their experiences of NEST. I participated in a NEST parent workshop, so I had the opportunity to talk to parents about their experiences with NEST. I was very fortunate to have a meeting with the New York Department of Education staff, with the NYU support staff and therapy teams, and I spent a day with the founder of NEST, Dorothy Siegel, she's an action powerhouse woman, and I was so privileged to have that day. So what was that the benefit of NEST everyone that was involved in the process. I saw students engaged with respectful relationships with teachers, genuinely loved and enjoyed their job. It was so overwhelming to see these teachers have such a wonderful engagement with their students and love what they do. I spoke with families who said to me, NEST has created this community for them and for their children. Their children have friends, their children have a sense of connection to their peers. I witnessed peers normalize difference. Their peers were, you know, that's just Jack who, yeah, he has autism, but it wasn't Jack as being different or in some way, I suppose, you know, they recognized what autism was and what autism meant for their peers. And it was just about, well, that's what they do, that's what they need. We can all contribute to their success in the classroom. And for the portability issue, I found it was easy to use the flexibility of the NEST model to engage with the diversity of the different schools. So it seemed to me to be very portable to take. It wasn't reliant on specific aspects of culture in order to be successful. I found there were some non-negotiables around NEST. It required some very significant structural change in terms of a did require a budget of support, which in both Denmark and in New York came from the Departments of Education. It was targeted to a specific ASD population, so students who were quite high functioning and engaging in the regular curriculum, and it did require some staff buy-in. None of these things I think are insurmountable, but it does require some investment of time, energy and money. So since my return, I've had ongoing meetings with the New South Wales Department of Education with an initial conversation to look at some pilot project discussions, even around starting a pilot project looking at simply co-teaching and then looking to move to implement NEST later on. These discussions were hijacked by what we now know as COVID-19, which sort of put a spanner in everybody's works. And then following that, there was a significant restructuring and innovation. So at this point in time, I'm still engaged in conversations and hoping to move my pilot project forward. And I'm watch this space because things are I'm determined that things will happen. So I'm aware that my 12 minutes are up. So just want to shout out, thank you to the Churchill Fellows for inviting me for this presentation, to the Churchill Trust for and the Fairfax Family Foundation for sponsoring my fellowship visit. It was a life-changing experience for me, and I'm eternally grateful for the opportunities that afforded me and the connections it gave, particularly the ASDNS teams in New York and in Aarhus. It's quite inspiring, and I'm more than happy to share those contacts with anyone who may be interested. So thank you. That's me in 12 minutes.
I'm hoping I've got my mute turned off. Yes, that's a great presentation. I've got a number of questions I'd like to ask you myself at the end. And our next presentation is Robert Lawson. And Robert, a little bit about you before I hand over to you to start. Robin left school at the end of year 10, became an apprentice chef, worked in clubs and restaurants, even cooked for 3 different prime ministers. I don't know if I could have resisted the temptation, Robert. And Robert had his own business in Coffs Harbour and was also employed by TAFE for 7 years before receiving a scholarship to become a teacher, ending up as head teacher TAS at Kirrawee High School. And Robert is currently a student pathways advisor. Given his pathway, he'd have a wealth of experience to pass on. He works with the State Office's senior pathways team. Robert's responsibilities includes providing advice and developing programs and resources that facilitate the successful transition from school to work for students in public schools. There are around 100,000 students with disabilities enrolled in New South Wales public schools, and his desire to help those students in particular to transition from the school environment into a fulfilling life led him to be awarded a Churchill Fellowship in 2017. And I'll leave it to you, Robert, to tell the rest of your story.
Thank you very much, Peter. So hopefully my presentation's just coming up. Okay, so is that all right, Peter? You got my presentation? Excellent, thank you. I too would like to acknowledge local land owners, the Aboriginal people, and pay my respects to elders past and present, but I also like to acknowledge the young people that we as educators can influence and who will be tomorrow's leaders. So, and also acknowledge anyone present here. Okay, when I first went to work at the Department of Education in Senior Pathways, I was having a look at school to work programs, and I asked one of my colleagues, what are we doing for young people with disability? And I was told, well, there's not a lot that happens. A lot of the work or work education happens after school. There was no consistent programs across the state. And so I sort of asked, why? Why would you wait until a young person with disability leaves school to try to teach them work skills, work education, prepare them for work? Because my understanding is that wouldn't it be better to do it while the students were at school in a familiar environment with people they know and start back in year 7 so you can have some repetition, build up those employment related skills and also learn about work and discuss careers, all the things that they need for a successful life after school. And was told, well, you know, you sort of, if you can find something, let us know. So I sort of did a bit of research, and thanks to the Churchill Fellowship that I received, I was lucky enough to visit America, the UK and Ireland and have a look at some programs over there that I'd identified. Okay, so as Peter said, back in 2017, there were just over 100,000 students with identified disability. That's increased, I would say, if it's not 20% now, I'd be very surprised. We've got a lot of mental health issues that are now identified as a disability. So that it wouldn't even surprise me if it went up to 25%. And that's what all the countries I've visited said, between 20 and 25% of students now have a disability. A lot of mental health issues. Okay, as I said, my study tour, I was lucky enough to go to America. Project Search, what a great project, what a great program that is. It's delivered across 5 or 6 different countries now. I think there was about 500 sites that are delivering this program. It's more an internship program that's delivered within a large employer, such as a hospital or a large bank. Went to Ireland, visited Trinity College. That was really good, really interesting. And some of the schools I visited are listed there, and I'll talk a bit more about those in particular because they're the ones that have the programs that are just so much better than what I've seen around here. And when I visited the UK, I had talks with the Department of Education there, both in regards to vet courses and also with what they're doing now, the SEND unit, in regards to what they're doing to support young people with disability transition into work, and also visited some schools, which was very interesting, really great stuff happening over there. What I'm going to do is just put some of the lessons I've picked up, some of the things I've picked up on the screen, and I'll talk to you about some of the schools that I went to while you're reading that. One of them was in Brighton, St. John's. Their whole senior program is based on 5 outcome areas, which is wellbeing, communication, skills, independence, and employability. They actually, the preparing young people for life after school and work was so important to them. They had lots of different projects within the school, and each project actually had a name, a logo, and a business. They had the Cafe Deli, which a lot of schools do, even here. They had a print little business going. They ran Flourish, which was a little garden they had with flowers, and they would have pop-up shops selling flowers and provide bouquets to restaurants. Just several different foundations was their woodworking one. And they would put the kids through these business. They even had some of those businesses in industrial areas, so the young people would have travel training as well. So they were really good, very, very much about preparing the young person for work. They had great partnerships with businesses as well. The other school of note that I went to was in Bath, and that was the Three Ways. They were so far ahead in a lot of stuff they were doing. They had an oval-shaped room, and this is probably going to be a bit off track. They had an oval-shaped room with 3 projectors in the roof, so they could project like students were in an airplane. And also the floor moved and vibrated with music, so they would do travel training and take kids on tours and flights and all sorts of things. It was really good. But they also had a lot of a really good work experience program, but which started at school. So the young people would do shadowing programs with the GA. They would do jobs around the school. But they had a cafe, similar to what a lot of schools do here in New South Wales. A lot of them have got cafes and coffee shops, but they actually built their cafe outside the school grounds, so that way people didn't have to come through the school, and they employed a person to manage that cafe. So they had all the local businesses and people coming to the cafe, so it was a really good experience for the young people. But they would also have the mums who would drop kids off to school come in for morning tea and snacks in the morning and in the afternoon. So it was just a great concept that I hadn't seen done. I thought it was really good. And they were very, very busy. So there's 2 schools, a lot of focus on teaching kids the employment related skills and preparing them for work experience and then actually going out on work experience. And there's just a few more notes there on the UK. And the Department of Education UK, they were really pushing supported internships. So students would stay for an extra year and they would go on a supported internship into a workplace for 6 months. They would be supported by the person who would teach work skills, but also someone from the department would drop in on and make sure they're okay. And they were having a 60% success rate of employment for those young people, which was pretty good at the time, because in the UK, their success rate for employment for people with disability was about 6% or something. So they were really pleased with that. Okay, I'll go on to Ireland now. Ireland schools were also so committed to preparing young people for life after school, including work, that the schools would actually have their whole senior curriculum based around preparing young people for work. one of the schools at Black Rock near Dublin. They would have for their senior kids, so year 11 and 12 kids say, in the morning for year 11, they would have their academic session, then they'd have their break, and then the rest of the day was rotating through different work areas. In the school itself, it had on-campus accommodations, so they were doing all the usual hospitality, business services, the cleaning and preparing of the rooms on their on-site accommodation. They had car detailing and they had some woodwork and other things going on. So the students would rotate through all the areas that they were offering in the afternoon. Then in year 12, it would swap around. In the morning, they would choose one they preferred and they'd focus on that work area. And then they would do academic stuff in the afternoon. So very unlike New South Wales, where a lot of schools are trying to push a lot of curriculum to kids, which quite often they might not be able to use when they leave school because they can't get a job because they haven't had work experience. They don't understand what an employer wants. They don't understand how to work or hold themselves and what they need to do and what attributes they need in the workplace. So that's a big, big difference over there. A lot of focus on preparing students for post-school. Okay, there's some more lessons learnt. Now, and there's some pictures of the kids there. The interesting thing too, I walked into one of the maths class in one of the schools in Ireland and they were doing their maths with money. So they were doing their subtraction, addition, multiplication, all with fake, they had the fake notes and coins, the Irish notes and coins, and that's how they were doing their maths. That's how keen they were to relate what they were doing to life after school. They really loved it when I pulled out some Australian notes and having a look at, had a look at those. So. Okay, America, as I said earlier on, Project Search was one of the programs that is working really well all around the world. The UK, a lot of the hospitals in UK have got Project Search. And one of my colleagues, or a Churchill Fellow colleague, so to speak, Ebru, she also went over and had a look at Project Search. They're really good. And Ebru and I have been working together to try to see if we can bring that to Australia. And with the Public Service Commission, perhaps being the host employer. But also while we're in America, I visited a couple of schools as well. And what was interesting, one of the schools, they preparing young people for life after school and work after school, they would have where kids would actually run like a festival, a music festival, like a business. They would promote it, they would prepare for it, then they would have jobs during the festival. Then they would also have a volunteering program where they would go out and volunteer. But then their final thing they would do is what they call their walkabout program. And they would assist the young people, obviously depending on the level of disability, to go anywhere in the world and spend a month in another country with a host who's would take them to their workplace. So for example, a young person would come and stay with me and would spend the day in my workplace, which I thought was really good. So there's a few more of those lessons that we picked up in America. I'll just move on to the next one. I'll just go back for that for a sec. So I've been lucky enough in my work, I talk to a lot of different conferences about the advantages of work experience and why students should do work experience. So I was able to gel in the work that I've done with the young people with disability. I work quite closely with the Inclusion Directorate now. They used to be Disability Learning and Support, but now with the reshuffle, they're called the Inclusive Directorate. Doing a lot of work with those guys. Do presentations. They do have had virtual careers expos, and I've been able to speak at the careers expos. I've been lucky enough to speak at a few different national conferences for disability as well. And some of the things that I set out to do was, I also believe that for young people with disability or for anything to happen into a school, it's got to be through curriculum. So I did some work on the work education curriculum, which is 7 to 10. We got writers in to write all the programs and assessments, but what we did, were very inclusive. Two of the writers, one was a head teacher from a support unit, the other one worked in an SSP, a school for special purpose. We had two teachers from schools with very high refugee ESL background, and we wrote the work education program with all the resources, all done, all completed, so that they could just pick them up and apply them in school, which has been quite successful as well. So I think I might leave it at that. So if anyone's got any questions, I'm happy to answer them at the end. Peter, am I right for time?
You're right for time. Thank you very much, Robert. It's very informative. It seems like inclusion is the theme of the first two presentations. And we're off to our final presenter for the night, Jackie Charles. Jackie's fellowship was to research best practice in court education for school students. And notably, Jackie was the first Australian to complete the virtual Churchill Fellowship. Because of COVID, travel wasn't able to be happening. So Jackie was the first one to sort out a way around that. And I'm sure she'll let us know how she did it. And I'm very interested to hear. Jackie has a master's in teaching from Sydney University, a Bachelor of Arts from Macquarie University, and a formal trade qualification as a chef. So we have two chefs presenting tonight. Jackie currently works as a clerk of two chambers for level 22 chambers in Sydney. Previously, she was the education manager for Australia's Magna Carta Institute, where she ran the first New South Wales court education program. Jackie has worked as a high school classroom teacher, a chef, a kitchen hand, a factory worker, and believes in lifelong learning and embracing opportunities. Well, Jackie, here's another opportunity for you.
Thank you so much, Peter. And hello, everybody. I'm going to try and keep to time as well, so that we've got lots of time for questions. So I've only just submitted my Churchill report. It was published last week. So I'm a little bit less far along my Churchill journey than the other presenters, but certainly wanted to share a little bit about what I learned through the process of doing the research. So I want to also acknowledge Indigenous people in Sydney and elsewhere. And, you know, one of the things that was amazing about the research that I did was the inclusion, diversity and equity focus of so many of the organisations that I worked with, and it's just so wonderful to see that reflected tonight. My Churchill Fellowship research was around an area that many may not be familiar with, which is court education, which is basically legal education for young people and school students in particular in a court or legal context. And as you can see on the slide, that involves people physically being in a court, but also just learning about civics and law more specifically in a variety of different ways and in a variety of different contexts. I was fortunate to receive the fellowship right before COVID-19 hit. In fact, I was ready to get on a plane 4 weeks after they closed the border. And as a result, reconfigured my fellowship to being one that was based in Newcastle for 5 weeks in January and February this year and traveled the world remotely. It was a real challenge. And I think that I look back on the logistics of it and I feel tired, and I think a lot of Churchill Fellows will relate to that, but I'm so thrilled that it's come to fruition and I'm able to share that the work that I did, because I feel like we all need to know that it's possible during these difficult times to still do the important work that we've got to do. My focus was very much meeting virtually with a variety of organizations. And there's the logos of a number of them on the screen now. Predominantly, I met via Zoom and using a combination of email and Zoom and some phone calls, I was able to spend many hours with court educators, lawyers, teachers, some students, judges and others all working in the legal education space for school students. And what I discovered was really comforting in many ways, because in Australia, court education is fragmented. There are some states in which there are no formal programs for students to learn about the law in a court context or even in a school context, aside from the legal studies subjects in year 11 and year 12. And what I found was that many of the organisations, courts and others overseas were struggling with some of the same difficulties that we had here, but they'd solved them in particularly innovative and interesting ways. And with the pivot to virtual education that occurred last year and continues in many countries still, it was really interesting to see how they took that knowledge, that experience that they had, and converted the goal online. And I was able to participate in a small number of those programs. Documenting my journey, as the Trust likes you to do, is quite tricky when you're spending it in a small cottage in Newcastle. But I managed to find ways by using social media to share my daily walks that I did in between Zoom sessions, dogs that I met locally, and of course the obligatory visit to the beach. One of the interesting things about doing a virtual fellowship was I'd meet with people in the US early in the morning, and I'd meet with people in the UK and Europe late in the evening. And that meant that the middle of the day I could have some recreation time or just write or think and process. And so in some ways I feel privileged that I was able to do that for that 5 weeks. I've just finished my report and it's now up on the Churchill website as of last week. And you know, if you'd like to read it or know a little bit more about it, please feel free to contact me. I was really fortunate to have a Sydney artist, Rocco Fazzari, do an artwork for the front cover, because I was acutely conscious that, unlike your wonderful presentations, I didn't have photographs of me overseas that I could share with the readers. So that is the front page. And within that, there are a number of findings and recommendations. I was overwhelmed with the generosity of court educators across the world. They gave me time when they were in lockdown. They gave me time when their children were homeschooling behind them. They sent me resources. They introduced me to their friends. They provided this incredibly warm and inclusive community of educators for me to be a part of. And that was just when people, particularly in the UK in January and in the US with the events in the capital in Washington DC, when they were going through the hardest of times themselves, like all teachers, they just opened their door and went, join us, be part of our community. I discovered that there's a lot more similarities than differences with Australia. I thought that I'd go overseas and find that everyone was doing a much better job of court education than we are. And discovered that in fact they have some of the same problems, but they've solved them in different ways. Everyone is concerned about the civic level of understanding of young people. Everybody's trying to find ways to make them more legally literate. Through the work, I was able to develop the taxonomy of best practice to start a conversation amongst educators globally about what court education looks like when it's done well. And I was able to negotiate access to programs for Australia. And I made my first phone call today to let a court in Brisbane know that I've got a program that I think they could use with their Indigenous students. So that was very exciting. I had four key recommendations that came out of my research. And these are really very simple, but very vital. And the key is that we need to use what is known amongst the not-profit sector as a theory of change to articulate how we're going to take students from not having legal literacy, not understanding the legal system, to having positive experiences and then have them meet outcomes that we set at the end of the process in the same way that students progress through a curriculum. I recommended that court educators be embedded in courts. Many of them work for not-for-profit organisations that are adjacent. I was one of those people. However, that embedded educator presence in a court allows for an outreach and education focus, and it impacts on the judges, the court personnel. And the best example of that is in the UK Supreme Court, where all the judges that join the court are instructed that they will engage in education programs, they will engage in outreach, they will be given training to do so. And as a result, they have an amazing plethora of education programs that are very successful. My favorite being one that's called Ask a Justice, where very senior judges sit on Skype with school students across the UK and beyond and answer their questions. And it's just delightful. I was able to have a glimpse of one of those programs. The third recommendation was for professional collaboration. I think both Kathy and Robert have spoken about the benefits of collaboration. And I think in education, it's everything. If we can work together, pool our knowledge and resources, we can really affect positive change in outcomes for young people and students. And lastly, an adoption of an explicit best practice focus. I think often it's easy to just do things the way that they've always been done without any rigor or consideration of how we can improve. But there are so many things that we can do better. And I'll just take you through just very briefly some of those elements that I identified. Excuse the education language for those that are not educators in the audience. It's difficult to articulate this without it, but I hope you get the gist. So all court education must be mapped to curriculum. It must be linked to learning outcomes. That seems like a no-brainer, but often that's not the case. It's got to be relevant to students. Relevance is everything. And their community and lived experience, and socially contextualized. In the UK, they run a program at the Justice Museum, which is about reducing knife crime in primary school students, which is a real issue once they hit our equivalent of year six. And they do that targeting particular communities where that's a problem. And they use it, they have presenters who are the same ethnicity and culture as those students doing the presenting. They have educators who come from those communities. And there's a real strong link to community because students don't exist in a vacuum. They exist in a social context. And the law exists in a social context. That we need to promote engagement through a variety of strategies, and we have to work with stakeholders and reflect communities. We have to promote diverse perspectives, and this is something which really came up a lot in the conversations I had in the US. The perspective of African American students was really one that was not always considered in civic and legal education. And with the Black Lives Matter movement and a focus on equity and inclusion and accessibility, that's starting to change. But there are real political issues, particularly in the US, and chatting frankly to educators about how they're solving those problems was just so enlightening for me as a white Australian woman. And I think that we can really use some of that knowledge to assist us in doing a better job of supporting Indigenous students and students from non-Anglo-Australian backgrounds. We have to be physically accessible to disabled students. It was wonderful to hear Robert and Kathy talk about how disabled students thrive when they're included. Often courts are not accessible to disabled people, or if they are, it's only in a very cursory way. And the resources that are produced are not accessible either. And we need to include them in our conversations, in our prisons, in our legal system. Many, many, many of the people that are participating that in a negative way are disabled. They're either through mental illness or through physical or intellectual disability. So we really need to be reaching out to those young people and helping them understand the system so they can avoid becoming part of it. Lastly, I thought, as someone whose Churchill Fellowship was very unusual and conducted virtually and at times, you know, really walking into the darkness in terms of how to do things and how to make it work and be successful, I think I learned that being open to learning is everything, and that's what we always encourage students to do, and it's something that it was just wonderful to relearn that myself. That people are resilient and amazing. I can't believe the resilience of our colleagues overseas. What they have been through is so immensely difficult. Many of them have lost family members to COVID. They've had hospitalizations, lengthy hospitalizations themselves. They've really had a difficult time. And being a Churchill Fellow really matters. It opens doors. People really value what we do and what we have to contribute. And lastly, I thought, in keeping with Kathy, I'd end on a quote from Sir Winston, which is, success is not final, failure is not fatal, it is the courage to continue that counts. And I think that's the key lesson that I learned from my experiences as a virtual fellow. I'll just stop the screen sharing so we can start the questions. Thank you very much, everybody, for listening to me.
Sounds like a great note to finish on there, Jackie. We have a question from Richard Baranski for, I called you Kathy, did I, Jackie?
No, it's okay.
I can't chew gum and talk at the same time. Question to Kathy from Richard Baranski. He also works with students that are 20 plus years of age, and some of them have autism. Do your research results apply to that group? He's a TAFE teacher, I might add.
Yes. I don't see why. I think the biggest, I think, outcome of my research is that we need to look at whole system change, and tertiary education is part of that system change. So there is definitely no reason that we can't look at, and TAFE is a perfect opportunity to look at co-teaching at smaller class sizes and actually embedding some more explicit social instruction that's more purposeful and targeted and appropriate for that age group. So I definitely, you know, if we're looking at whole system change, then I'd be looking at systemic change from the very get-go till, you know, education is a lifelong practice. So I don't see that what I'd be doing in terms of implementing something for students on the spectrum would be limited to school-age students. So it would definitely be a potential avenue for exploration.
He goes on to ask, where does he go to get some experience in teaching the autistic?
There's lots of qualifications, there's lots of professional learning and professional development out there. The best piece of learning you can undertake is actually a talk with autistic people and hear what they have to say. Learn from the autistic community, I think, is the most powerful instructional tool we have. But there are lots of opportunities out there to hear from people who are researching in the space, who sit themselves on the spectrum. So there's lots of availability for professional learning out there for educators, definitely.
Okay.
Can I just add to that, Peter? It might also be good to visit a school, pop in and be a volunteer to help out, especially being a TAFE teacher. You could go pop in a school, help out, maybe do some basic skills for the students, and at the same time you would be learning. That would be a good suggestion.
Well, that sounds excellent, Robert. I learned something just by listening to you, Kathy, the fact that if you know someone with autism, you know exactly one bit of autism. Everybody's got a different slice of that cake. And it surprised me. I thought it was much more of a category than you're telling me. And Jackie, your point about court education. What's the difference between court education and legal studies in a high school?
So I suppose the way that we can distinguish between those is legal studies is a subject that students undertake in year 11 and 12 across Australia. Those students are often self-selected and they're often quite academically able, not always, but frequently. Court education is something broader, so that could apply to students from years 9 and 10 in New South Wales. There are some primary school programs that have started in Victoria. Internationally, there are primary school programs. In Boston, there's a wonderful organization called Discovering Justice that runs court education programs for kindergarten to year 3 students. They visit their local court. They do a mock trial involving chickens. And it's just a fantastic introduction to the legal system. So I suppose when we think about subjects with legal content, they form part of the court education whole, but it's not the only part of it.
And, you know, I've always had the opinion that there's justice for the rich and not justice for the poor, but you've added an extra layer to that. There's justice for the people who know what's going on and a lack of justice for people who have never been told about their what courts are about.
Exactly. And I think that one of the things that, you know, the audience would know from their personal experience is that most people's first interaction with the legal system is negative. It's usually something involving they've driven their car after having too many beers, or they've got a family member who has a legal problem, or depending on the community they come from, it could be that, you know, a member of the family goes to jail. And so there's really not that sense of the legal system being a positive good in society and being something that we have ownership of as a community. And we have the ability to change as the community as well. And I think that that capacity for young people to contribute to that change is something that court education allows us to give young people the tools to bring about change in their communities. And there's a lot of international examples where young people have advocated for legal rights for children in their community, or there's a case at the moment in the Supreme Court in the US for young people's freedom of speech and what they can say about school when they're not at school, with a young girl saying something obnoxious about cheerleading on Snapchat and being penalised for that. So, you know, it's about engaging people in a positive way with something that's closed and negative and complicated, so that if they are part of it, they have knowledge, and knowledge is power in many respects. And for those communities in particular, knowledge can be very helpful.
Well, thank you. Promises the things to come, isn't it? Hopefully. And Kathy, I was thinking when you were talking about NEST schools and just how many benefits there are to the students. It appears to me that the including the autistic children in the class gave benefits to all the members of the class, not just the people with autism.
No, that's exactly right. And that's the whole premise behind inclusion. It's not just simply about saying that there's benefits here for the students with disability. The benefit to peers without disability is equally as valuable. You know, we want our society to be an inclusive and understanding society, and so we need to actually break down these barriers that being different is something that you don't want to be. We need to be celebrating diversity and encouraging our students to be cognizant of difference and how that contributes to the society that we live in and what contributions we all make. We don't all want to be the same, and we should value the fact that a lot of us are very, very different. And the NEST program does that. It normalizes difference, and it simply, that's just Jack and that's just what he does. And for me, that's a real benefit. If we can empower our future citizens to be more tolerant and more understanding and more knowledgeable of difference, then I think we're doing a great job.
It's always been a major complaint of mine about selective high schools, where all the bright kids get to learn how to deal with bright people and never learn how to deal with people who aren't on, you know, their plane. And they go away thinking other people who can't think in light speed are stupid and not worth things, and they could do worse. They could do better, I should say. And Robert, I was very interested in your talk about the Irish schools. Where was that curriculum where they were running music festivals? Was that for only for students with disabilities, or was it include everybody? Did it do a NSW?
The schools that I actually visited were for young people with disability. And I will say it was quite interesting talking to one of the staff there after the principal went out, because one was in a high socioeconomic area, and the staff member was telling us that they actually lucky they get plenty of employers that can take the students on because their parents are the business owners, the chief executives, etc. Where another school I visited, it was a bit the opposite. So, and I feel that is very much the same in Sydney. But the musical festival one was actually an American school, and they ran it as a business, and it was something they all got into. But what some of the other things the schools do, if there's a carnival or a market, they do little pop-up stalls. And if they're making items in woodwork, as I said, the flower posies that they deliver to restaurants, and they also sell the flowers and also the vegetables and mixed herbs they grow, they set up a little pop-up shop. They take a point of sale system, so they're learning to use a point of sale system to communicate, to work as a team, to deal with customers, and also take money and give change. So, yeah, a lot of good things happening overseas.
Is any part of that in the work education year 7 to 10 syllabus? That
there's a lot of scope for it. It just depends on how the school wants to apply the curriculum or what activities they want to use to teach the curriculum. So there is scope for it, and there are a lot of schools doing great things. There was a school down the south coast that had, with their washing, they had washing machine on site and dryers. They were actually starting up a little business, little laundromat for the local restaurants, just to do their tea towels and things like that. So once again, running a business, advertising, marketing, money, responsibility of collecting things, putting through the machine, folding iron, etc. So it is happening in New South Wales, but not
just for disabled students, or
once again an SSP school.
Yeah,
school for special purpose.
Because I was a math teacher many, many years ago, and I would have loved to have been able to have the anointment from the from Department of Education to do a lot more practical things. 95% of all the students I taught how to do calculus never used calculus again. They would have been better off using a point of sale. Yeah. Working out how to put a markup on an item you're going to sell at a pop-up store, all this type of stuff.
And that's exactly the curriculum that I was sort of talking about, in that what they were learning their maths, that with the point of sale system and giving change and taking money in a practical way, and they didn't realize they were learning maths. They just thought they were working in the store, but they were actually learning skills that they could use post-school without having all the curriculum stuff that for some of those young people wouldn't help them. I mean, even though I'm not knocking maths, literacy and numeracy is very important, but in some situations depends on what the content is that's trying to be delivered to them.
Yeah, I could spend all day talking about maths, and I just firmly believe no one should learn any more maths than they need. As simple as that. Most people I talk to think they're no good at maths, like people who think they can't sing because they've had bad experiences. Jackie, want to add something?
I just wanted to say to Robert, many, many years ago, I was a work studies teacher, and I actually ran a program for students at risk and transitioning them to employment. And I would have loved to have had a curriculum like yours. We ended up just making our own. And trying to get students work ready. They weren't disabled students, but many of them had significant mental health conditions and other I suppose, at-risk attributes. So it's just so pleasing to hear that that work's being done, because I think they're fantastic young people. They often are tremendously resilient and innovative and interesting. They just need those opportunities. So I was just thrilled to hear you talk about it.
Yeah, you're correct. Work studies is that senior one, and we're working on that right now, writing up the programs. So they're all packaged up nicely with a little red bow, so a teacher can grab them and put them through the class, but deliver it to the class. So that's the next project that the team I work with is working on at the moment, is work studies.
And Kathy, do you have anything to add to those words from Jackie and Robert? Is it applicable to autistic children and classrooms and things?
Well, life skills are applicable to everybody. whether a student has a disability or not, all of our students need life skills. They need to know how to survive in an ever-changing world, to be, you know, this notion of a typical global citizen, whatever that means. So it's not just about, and I'm very wary about saying this is only for a certain cohort of student or a certain cohort of disability, when what we should be doing is empowering all students with the work that we do, be that directly or indirectly as a peer. So projects such as what Robert's talking about have a dedicated purpose for students with disability, definitely, but not just exclusively. Yeah. They're important for everyone. So that's Robert's next step.
Well, as I said, the work education system that we did do, we included Aboriginal teachers, teachers with high ESL, the disability teachers. So that isn't written specifically for young people with disability. It is so anyone can pick it up and run with it. And the teachers who are on the writing team said, yep, no, this is good to go and support our students. But yeah, but there, and I don't know if you know, there's lots of great programs out there for young people with autism. They actually identify some of the traits of a young person with autism, great for certain jobs. For example, flying a drone. Drone flying is very big at the moment, especially in electrical field with the wires. And they say a young person with autism, if he sits there and focuses on just doing that and not being bothered by people, can do a great job. Another one I saw up in northern New South Wales or South Queensland was a big piggery, massive big piggery, and they asked 20 young people with autism to come up and do a work trial with them, and they found that because pigs, they need to be fed at the same time, the lights need to go on, go off, they need certain jobs done a specific way, and they found that some of those autistic traits that you sort of described earlier on absolutely suit that sort of work. And from the 20, they employed 19, and there was a beautiful interview with a young man. He said in his interview, well, who wouldn't like to work with animals, and I don't have to talk to anyone. So I thought, oh, that was quite beautiful.
if only we could all get jobs that we don't have to talk to anybody. Well, listen, that last conversation sort of just rounds off the whole approach tonight, and you guys have had a lot more in common than maybe your topics of your fellowships would lead us to believe. And so I'm looking forward to what comes out of your work, Jackie at the courts, and Kathy with NEST, and Robert with what would you call it, Robert?
School to work programs, I would say, probably one of the things we're working on at the moment. So
I'd like to thank you all, Jackie, Kathy, Robert, for your contribution tonight. It's been very informative. We didn't have as many questions as I thought we'd have, so it was a good thing I read your report. And I'd recommend to everybody listening, you could go on to the Trust website and download the reports from Jackie and Kathy and Robert, and get greater detail of what they have been speaking about tonight. And as well as that, if you have any questions you'd like to ask them through that same website, you could contact them. So the Trust passes it on to any fellow. And if you have an interest of your own, you can at that website, find other fellows maybe working in an area that you have a very strong interest in, and ask them questions as well. And I'm just checking to make sure I've done everything. Thanks, Ian, for your help in setting all this up. And also Elizabeth Comino, another member of the committee who's done a lot of work to set all this up. And the last thing, without running over time too far, we intend to start a special interest group amongst fellows and friends just for education topics. So we'll be looking to run chats and more walks. For those of you who don't know, a chat is similar to what we've done tonight, where people present their findings and answer questions. And a walk is when people get invited. No doubt each of the three people tonight may have a location they might like other people, when COVID permits, to come along and visit and see hands-on experience. So thank you all very much. And Kathy, thank you for that picture that you showed earlier that I saw in your report. The quote from Churchill, she traveled all the way around the world, went to Denmark.
Right.
And on a wall on a room in Denmark school, a quote from Winston Churchill. How poignant. And yep. I've been using that quote ever since I read it. And the quote reads, for those who weren't quick enough to read it, "Continuous effort, not strength or intelligence, is the key to unlocking our potential." Doesn't that speak volumes for the kids coping with autism, for the vulnerable groups who have troubles with the law and need to know more about it, and for people at school who actually want to get a job, a fulfilling job, rather than go and do a HSC? I bet you they don't have a HSC in Ireland. So thank you all very much, and thank everybody for the patience and some of my miswords.
thanks, Peter. I just want to step in and once again, on behalf of the Churchill Fellows Association, thank Jackie, Kathy, and Robert for your time tonight. Great presentation. Thank you, Peter, for hosting. I'm sure you've all enjoyed it. Don't forget, if you've got questions, you can always send questions to the association. Our email, I'll just remember this, secretary. So secretary at, and it's all one word, Churchill Fellows NSW. So secretary at churchillfellowsnsw, one word, .org.au. We'll certainly pass those questions on. Can I just remind those of you who are interested, on the 14th of May, we're having a medallion dinner in the city. That's where we're presenting some fellows from a few years ago. Bear in mind, there's still about 50 fellows who haven't traveled. How would you feel, those of you that are fellows, to get your fellowship and then, due to world circumstances, not being able to travel? We have about 50 in those circumstances. So if you'd like to show some support to those people, we're looking for mentors. If you want to chat with them, we're going to try. We have been organizing a few events just to keep them inspired. Jackie, you are a real inspiration because you have stepped out and done a virtual fellowship. So we really congratulate you as the first ever in Australia fellow to do a virtual fellowship, and maybe there will be others that follow. But just bear in mind,
thank you, Ian, and I'm happy to talk to anybody who's on the call tonight. If you're considering doing a virtual fellowship, contact me. I'm supporting now a number of virtual fellows in the UK who you know, just needed some encouragement and just a bit of practical help, and a number in Australia as well. But please feel free to get in touch. I'm happy to chat on the phone and help you solve some of the practical and then the other issues that arise from doing something where you just sit in a room by yourself, as we've all done. So feel free to be in touch.
Thanks, Jackie. And if any of you there would like to help out and show your support to any of those people that haven't traveled, get in touch with us through that email, and we'll have a number of events. You might like to join us for a dinner or something with those people. Can I also encourage everyone, the weekend of the 8th, 9th and 10th of October, we're going to get on an aeroplane, hopefully, fingers crossed, and we're going to go to Brisbane That's if Queensland lets us, but it's a national convention. If you have not been to a Churchill National Convention, you're really missing out. They are a great time. There'll be hundreds from right across Australia. The presentations are brilliant. It's just a great weekend. It's every 2 years. Queensland are hosting it this year, the 8th, 9th and 10th of October in Brisbane. Now's the time to register and book in. There's more details on our Facebook page. Thank you, everybody. What I'm going to do, I know we've officially finished. So we're finished, but there's still a lot of people there. If you want to unmute and turn your camera on and say hi to anyone, we're all finished. You can log off if you'd like. But if you want to go to gallery view and just sort of wave at everyone and let everyone know that you're here, turn your videos on. Yeah, look, there's some videos coming on. That's it. Have a wave at everyone. And if you want to unmute, we'll leave it open for a while if you just want to have an open chat. But thank you.